I want to start out by just giving you the down and dirty, and it's something to kind of keep in mind for staying fit, keeping your brain healthy, and keeping your body healthy for as long as possible. And I always talk about a triangle. So if in your mind you can think of a triangle, and it's going to be an activity triangle. So think of this as your activity triangle. There's three activities to do every single day. And if you do these activities every single day, at least to some extent, you will stay as fit as possible, as long as possible, okay? There's never any guarantees and never any promises that by doing this, you'll never get Alzheimer's or you'll never have a heart problem or anything. But it's a down and dirty three, it's kind of the magic threesome. It's not exclusive of other things, but it's something to keep in mind. So your activity triangle is this. The three activities to incorporate into your life every single year are social activities, stay connected with others, physical activities, keep moving, and mental activities, keep your brain active, okay? So your three activities to do every day are social activities, mental activities, and physical activities. Basically, the research is showing that physically, if you can get about 4,500 steps in a day, that's kind of a minimum, but also the amount of walking that they have found out to be very, very good. The 10,000 steps a day is an ideal that somebody came up with, and if it works for you, it works, but you don't have to get that many steps in a day. So get your 4,500 steps in a day if you can, and then do other exercises as well. Do some strengthening exercises and some stretching exercises, and some of those just take 30 seconds to do. So that's mental exercises. The goal is to do what you love to do. If you like crossword puzzles, if you like jigsaw puzzles, if you like Sudoku, do what you love to do. But the other part of mental exercises is to try to do something that's going to be a little different than what you usually do. So the idea is to stretch your brain a little bit. Do something that you're not quite as familiar with. So stretch it out. If you have done crossword puzzles forever, do a little bit harder version. Or if you like the word search puzzles, keep doing those, but maybe do another kind of a version. So the whole idea of brain fitness is to do something that's a little more unusual, something that you haven't done before. But keep doing what you like to do. Don't force yourself to do what you hate because you're not going to want to do it. Don't force yourself to physically exercise and doing some things you can't stand because you're not going to do it. So try to find what you like to do in the activities, even social activity. Don't feel you have to socialize with people you don't like to socialize with. We all have people in our lives that we prefer not to socialize with. Sometimes we have to, and sometimes we don't. So make those decisions. But for people that you enjoy being with, please find ways to be with the people, whether it's electronic, whether it's over the phone, whether it's, you know, a telephone call, whether it's FaceTiming, whether it's now, like being outdoors like this. We're so fortunate, and it's been a good summer to be outdoors for the most part. We've been very fortunate to be able to do that. So stay connected with people. Reconnect maybe with some old friends that you haven't thought of in a while. Write a letter. Wow. How many of you have gotten a handwritten note or handwritten letter and it's made your day? It's such a surprise to get something handwritten anymore, so you can then share that with some others. And the Clinton Township Senior Center is developing a pen pal arrangement. And see Debbie for more information on that. But we might be able to establish a relationship with another senior, maybe who is out at Shelby, or maybe who's in another care facility that can't get out. And if we can write a note once a week or once a month to a person that doesn't have others that are writing notes, that is a way to connect with someone. Maybe we'll never meet that person in person, but we can connect with that person socially by writing a note. So that's just something. Those are some ideas to stay socially connected and connected in ways you maybe hadn't thought of doing. But I know that receiving a handwritten note, there's nothing like it. So receiving it and so sending it to someone else is a good thing too. So how about, you know, even former friends of yours that you might not have thought of for a while, if you have their address, send a note. So the activity triangle, the down and dirty, this is good for your brain. It's good for brain fitness. Stay active physically, socially, and mentally every single day. And it's something that we can do every single day. You've already started out today because I had to shush you up to start. So you've already started out socially, right? And you will continue to be social. So you can check that one up already. Excuse me. Well, a little bit physically active to walk from your parking place all the way around here. You got some steps in already. Maybe even before you leave, we could walk around where it's shady back there before we go back to the car. It's a thought, okay? And these trails here, Keith is laughing. The trails here, a lot of them are in the shady area, so it's just another possibility. And then mentally active, we're gonna be that. We're gonna do that today. So when you leave here from this program today, you will have completed your triangle activities for today. You can go to bed tonight and say, wow, I can check off physically active, socially active, and mentally active because I did it at the brain fitness class at the senior center today. And the senior center has a lot of things going on that will keep you active for as long as possible. The other thing I just really do want to say in talking about keeping your brain fit is that there are no guarantees. And this is kind of the thing I like to slip in, because sometimes people will say, I've done everything that I'm supposed to do and I'm losing my mind, or I'm depressed, or something is going on that I don't know what to do about. So other things happen as well. Another piece maybe to keep in mind too is your nutrition and hydration. I mentioned the hydration. By the time we're done, your water should be empty. Your water bottle should be empty, okay? So that's one way. I'll have to keep mine going too. And your nutrition is important. Really try to get, and I think you all know the basics of nutrition, try to get your vegetables in, some fruits, enough protein, a little bit of fat every single day, because that's an important thing too. And don't beat yourself up if you eat too many cookies, because we all do that now and again, but try not to do it too often. I guess that's the other part. So what we're going to be doing today, Debbie's making more copies of this, so we'll just kind of wait a minute for that. But what we're going to be doing today is talking a little bit about memory. And one way to trigger memory is to kind of go back in time. So the project that we're going to be doing once we get through our startup activity, the project that we're going to be doing is a timeline. Each of you to do a personal timeline. And I've got scrap paper and I've got guidance for that. But I thought you might like to be interested in, I can give you a little bit of a preview on what this is going to look like. A timeline would be something that if we had a big piece of paper or a chalkboard or something, we will start out, and this is individually for each of you. So you were all born in a different year. So for you, it's going to start out the decade you're born in. That's the first thing you're going to write on your timeline. What decade were you born in? Were you born in the 1940s or the 30s or the 50s? So when you do a timeline, we're going to start out on the scrap paper that I have with the decade you're born in. Don't write down anything yet because I'll go back over this, but I just thought I'd introduce it while Debbie is making some more copies. The timeline. So the decade you're born in, I was born in 1941. So that's the decade I was born in. So the very first decade on my timeline will be the 1940s. And then the next decade on my timeline will be the 1950s, and then the 60s, and so on, right up through 2020. Because we're at the beginning of a brand new decade. So that's what we're gonna do. We're gonna write those down across the paper that I give you a little bit from now. And then, we're going to do a few specific things with that timeline, but in talking about memory, a lot of research has been showing that if we think about some things in the past, we're activating our long-term memory and bringing it to the present. And it's a good exercise to do this. And I think if we do it by ourselves, but also together, you know, it's interesting how we can do something for ourselves, but like you're all at tables, to do this then together also can trigger some things. So that's going to be the main activity we're going to do today. But prior to that, We'll get back to the kind of one that triggers our thinking today. Everybody has a copy of the pen game. Okay, so the last time here we did the double trouble. For those of you who weren't here, do it at home, okay? Because I don't want to go back over what we did last week. But on the back of that is something called the pen game. And it's kind of, it depends on your verbal skills and so on. So for some, this is easier than for others, and I wouldn't expect everybody here to know every one of these things. Okay, so everybody got the pen game up? And the idea with the pen game is there are 19 words, phrases, or expressions. Each should suggest an expression or word which contains the word pen, P-E-N. For example, a rooftop apartment is a penthouse. Okay? This is how it goes. So the P-E-N could be anywhere in the word. All right? So let's do this together instead of waiting for you to do it singly. Let's do it together. Okay? So what is a strip of land surrounded on three sides by water? A peninsula, okay? Here's one that I sure didn't know. Does anybody know who Ulysses' faithful wife was? Penelope. Good. Penelope. What is the intestinal organ frequently the site of an inflammation? Appendix. Good. You are sharp people. Number four, what is a public amusement area featuring coin-operated games? We think of arcade, but there's a word before arcade. Penny arcade. Uh-huh. Yep. Okay. What is in a thoughtful mood? Pensive. Good. What is number six, imminent, about to occur? Pending, good. Where are we? Oh, number seven, the last but one of a series. Okay, this one I don't even know. It's called penultimate. Penultimate is number seven, P-E-N-U-L-T-I-M-A-T-E. We learned a new word today. How about that? And it's a word that I don't know how often we even use it. But we may. You know, if we do a series here or something, the next to the last one, now we have a new name for it, the penultimate. Okay, number eight, what is a seaport in Southwest Florida? Pensacola. Some of you would know that, some would not know that. What is to pierce or perforate? Penetrate. Penetrate. What is to begin, or another meaning is good, open. A Middle Eastern state, home of the Liberty Bell. The state, the name of the state? Pennsylvania. Number 12, what is a strong liking or fondness for something? Penchant, good, penchant. What is number 13, extreme poverty? Penury. That's a word we're not hearing too often. However, we're also seeing people with the COVID. Penury, P-E-N-U-R-Y. It could be penniless. Good, Rochelle. Oh, that was Linda? Or Laura? Okay. Number 14 now, we're up to number 14. What is a condensed summary or a shortened collection? Not one, not another word. It's another word we don't use too often. It's called a compendium. Oh, so if you haven't heard that word, it's another new one for your vocabulary. See if you have an opportunity today to use the word compendium. If you go to the library, maybe you could ask for a compendium of Shakespearean works or something. Okay, 15 maybe you know it. The swinging part of a grandfather clock? Good, pendulum. What is a frugal, stingy person?
Penny pincher.
A penny pincher. What is an island off the coast of the Northwest Malaya? That one, probably you don't know, and this shows you how old this worksheet is, because it's the Malaya Peninsula is Malaysia and some other countries now too. But it is called Penang, P-E-N-A-N-G. How about this one? It could apply a lot today. It's the emotion, an emotion that's held to the breaking point.
Pent up
emotions. I think we're seeing a lot of that today with COVID. And then to develop or to reach maturity. Think of a peach or a fruit to ripen. Oops. Okay, you got that one. That was a gift. Ripen, yeah. So I think the clue might be a little bit hard. So all of us folks are ripening human beings in our older years. So that's that, it's a continuation from last week. And for those of you who weren't here last week when we did the one on the back, I think you'll be able to get most of those by doing them at home. So that's your homework if you want to. Okay, so now we're going to be going back in time, and as I mentioned earlier, this is the personal timeline we're going to do. But a quick little story. I don't know too much about my ancestors, in part because I grew up on Long Island, New York, and every summer for the month of July, our family drove from Long Island up to a town called Oneida, New York, which is near Syracuse. And that was before expressways. And so it was a grueling 12-hour drive to get 300 miles to go from where we grew up to Grandma's house. Now, Grandma was such that she really, she wasn't particularly a warm person, but she was a really lovely lady and very bright. But she believed that if you reminisce about the olden days, it was a sign that you're senile. This is what she believed. Now, we're talking back in the 50s, probably in the 40s and 50s. My grandma believed that to reminisce was a sign of senility. So I never heard much about her family or how she grew up. And she grew up pretty poor, as many, many, many people did back in the early 1900s. But I never heard too much about that. Because she believed that if she did that, it was a sign that she was, they didn't use the term dementia, but it was a sign that she was senile, and she certainly wasn't senile, and she didn't want to become senile, so she didn't reminisce with me. That has changed. And the research paper that I handed out to you is titled, Stimulate Your Brain with a Trip Down Memory Lane. So it's just the opposite of what she believed and what she taught me in those early years, which isn't it bizarre how things change? But isn't it also bizarre sometimes if what we think is true, we believe it so firmly, but then we find out, no, that isn't true. I wish she was alive, well, it can't happen, but in some ways I think if she were alive today, I'd find out a lot more. Now, I did hear about some of the successes in the family and some of those, but I didn't hear about a lot of the heritage. Later on, I did find a deed for some property that a great-great-grandfather had signed when he came over from Ireland. He was illiterate, and he signed this deed with an X. Now, my grandma would never have admitted that. But my mother did. She says, look at this piece of paper that I found. And it was a deed to property back in the mid-1800s that my grandpa signed with an X because he couldn't print his or write his name. And that was not unusual, but it might have been embarrassing to my grandmother, and so she didn't say it. Today we find it much more fascinating, I think. I'll get to you in a minute, okay?
How about my grandfather?
Yeah. So let's take a look at the stimulate your brain with a trip down memory lane. We're going to do this, and I'm going to highlight a few things, and then you're going to go down your own memory lane, and it's not a sign of senility. It's a sign to stimulate your memory. The subheading is the mental challenge involved in trying to recall people, places, and events from the past helps strengthen brain connections. Well, isn't that nice to know? So we can reminisce, we can go down memory lane, and it's going to strengthen memory connections in your brain, and it will help to do that. By the way, every time you do go back in time and go back into your older long-term memory and bring those memories to today, they are no longer just long-term memories, they become current. So when you go into your brain and you bring out stuff from the past, it is now current again. So you're bringing it forward into short-term memory to use it again, okay? That's what we do sometimes when we problem solve. For all of us, we are older than our adult children. We're certainly a lot older than our grandchildren. That goes without saying. But the other part of that is we've lived a lot, and so we have a lot of memories that help us to make decisions today that our adult children don't have yet because they haven't lived long enough to have those experiences. And certainly our grandchildren haven't lived long enough to have the experiences that we have had. So when we make a decision today, it's based on 60, 70, 80 years of experience, the failures, the successes that we have had that the younger people haven't had yet. So that's bringing our long-term experiences to today to say, no, I'm not going to take out this loan because it's not a good idea. Because we've learned from the past that we've been built, or we've learned that other people have been, and so we're using that experience. We know today, and sometimes we talk about this on our walks, we know today that if I'm going to move, I'm not going to move into a house or an apartment that up, down, up, down, up, down, because that used to be cool, but now it's too hard for me. So now if I move, it's going to be on one floor. But I only know that because of my physical condition today. But when I was in my 40s, that was fine. I could do flights of stairs that were tremendous. So I mention this because every decision we make today is based on my condition today, but also experiences from the past. Okay, so let's take a look at a few of the things in this paragraph here. In the second paragraph, I just highlighted a few of these things because I don't want to spend too much time on the article, because I want to give you time to do the your own timeline. The second paragraph starts out by saying, recollection as a strategy to improve brain functioning makes a lot of sense, especially if you're concerned about memory loss. Making a serious effort to recall your past utilizes the parts of the brain involved in memory processes, focusing directly on the ability to store and retrieve memories and strengthening those connections. So that second paragraph is just loaded with good research information that you can use or you can think about as you're recalling the past. You're not just living in the past, you're recalling the past there. The more you reach for these memories, the deeper your mental processing becomes, and the richer are the memories you can produce. So we're going to start that process today by having you do your own individual timeline. The next paragraph under memory stimulation says, engaging in a detailed trip down memory lane will give your brain a workout as you enjoy rewarding memories of the people and events that have shaped your life. And there's many possible ways to revisit your past, and they go through some of them. I'm just going to hit the highlights because I think we all know some of these anyway. Go through old pictures or new pictures. Go through your photo albums. If you have old pictures from your your parents and so on, and you look on the back and they didn't mark them or say who this was. I said, I wonder who this old lady is in this picture. So you're lucky if somebody before you marked them, but for many of us, we don't have that. The next bullet point is contact old friends. This is something we can do. You say, you know, I wonder how she's doing. I haven't talked to her in 20 years. Maybe you want to look her up. Map your past. This is an interesting one I would venture to do, but we're not going to specifically do this today. But I think this is kind of an interesting thing to do. Exercise your visual spatial memory ability by, for example, trying to recollect the place where you grew up, laying out the plan of your neighborhood street by street, or draw detailed plans of the apartments or houses you have lived in. Can you reconstruct your route to school or work? Refer to a map to revive your memories if needed. We're not going to do this today, but I think this could be fun. You know, sit down and say, okay, this is how I got from my house to my elementary school, and see how many street names you can remember, if any. But on the way, like how many blocks did you have to walk? How did you get there? What did you pass? Or who did you pass? Those kinds of things. So I think that can be kind of fun and interesting thing to do when you're home. Rememorizing. Can you still remember a poem you learned? Back in high school, we had certain poems we had to memorize. Can you still remember them? Okay. I'm not going to ask for anybody to venture on that one. But there was, you know, there was some. But I wonder if, like with the Gettysburg Address, it's easy to look up on your phone. And if it starts off, maybe you can remember some of it and then go back and remember more of it. In time, I bet it would come back to you pretty quickly if you had to memorize that a long time ago. But if you haven't used it in 50 years, for most of us, it's not going to come back very quickly. Recreate favorite recipes and then listen to oldies, okay? I did bring some music that we can play, oldies music. But anyway, this is something that I think will be fun to do today. So and then in the box up in the upper right, it's what you can do. It gives you some ideas on how to be more efficient at doing these. And what I'm here to tell you sometimes is what the research is showing you, and it's always good to know that. The research-based suggestions for boosting the ability to recall information. So these research-based things, one is close your eyes while trying to recall something. Close your eyes. That clears out a lot of the current distractions. Take breaks. The brain sometimes need breaks to get back into that. Scroll through the alphabet to help you remember names. Limit distractions. That's one of the things you do when you close your eyes also. You're limiting distractions. So try to do this recall without playing current music or whatever. And then adopt a healthy lifestyle. We talk about that a little bit all the time. So the first thing you're going to write in the upper left hand, is the decade you were born in. So as I mentioned before, I was born in 1941. So my first decade would be 1940 to 1950. And then next to that, write the next decade, 1950 to 1960. And then next to that, write the next decade, 1960 to 1970. If you were born in the 1950s, that will be your first decade. If you were born in the 1960s, that will be your first decade. If you were born in the 1930s, that will be your first decade. So go horizontally like this. Yeah, you're going to need that kind of space. And you're going to write stuff down under each decade. So give yourself, you know, you might only get 5 decades across on one sheet of paper, and then use the other sheet of paper for the next 4 or 5 decades you're writing. This is just the start of mine. So it looks something like this. Yeah, you got it. You got it. Now, in the first decade, write your ages during that decade. So if you were born like in 1935, like one woman said, in the 1930s, she was age 1 to 5, because by the next decade, she was ages 5 to 15. So underneath the decade, write what age range you had during that decade. And when you get up to 2020, you don't really have an age range. You have the age you are today. Now, if you go back to the yellow sheet of paper, maybe it's white for you, where it says ideas for your timeline. Now, the next thing, so you know what age you are in each decade. Now go back to the first decade and let's see, what will we, I'd like you to write down where you lived. Was it Detroit? Was it Mount Clemens? Was it Clinton Township? Was it Germany? Was it, and to do this for each decade, where did you live? If you can remember, if you can remember the name of the street, you can add that in. This is part of, again, stretching those brain cells to get a little bit more specific. But where did you live the year, the decade you were born? Maybe in two places. Maybe you moved or your family moved. So do this for each decade, ending with where you live now. And maybe you lived in the same place for the last 50 years. That would make it easy. But write it down in each decade. Where did you live? Maybe go back and write down in the appropriate decade where you went to school. And it might be, you know, in one decade, like your teen years, you might have gone to, and if you can think of the school's name, all the better. And if you can't, just write high school or what it might be. So think about that. Where did you go to school? And maybe for some of you, you've been to school in your 40s or 50s or 60s, so put that into the correct decade also. Did you go to the community college? Okay. When you were older? So for some of us, schooling didn't stop at high school, and maybe it picked up again as we're older adults. So put down the name of the school you went to or the schools. And I'm going to give you a little secret too. As you think of these things now, or can't think of them now, sometime this afternoon or tonight, or when you're in the shower, you think, oh, I remember my best friend that I used to play dolls with back on my back porch, and her name was, and it will come, but it may take a while. So these memory exercises aren't meant to be perfect right now. They're meant to kind of stimulate your travels back in time so that as the day goes on or the time goes on, these things are going to occur to you later today. But I don't want you to get frustrated because you can't think of it right now. Because most of the time we can't. We can't command our brain to do what we want it to do at the time we want it to do it, can we? But we do think of things later when we're more relaxed or we're not trying so hard. For those of you who have had children, what decade were your children born in, or what decades were your children born in? For those of you who have had, we've all had deaths in the family. Can you remember what decade your mother or your father died? So it can be interesting to remember births and deaths and put those in the perspective of your timeline. For some people, they lost a parent very young. For others, we lost our parent when we were much, much older. You can put those in your timeline. When did your grandma, grandpa, aunt, uncle, cousins die? When were they born? Do you remember the birth of your siblings? What decade were you when your siblings were born? What decade were you when you married? Divorced? Widowed? Think back, and I use the word hobbies very, very generally, but think back into some of those things that you've done over your lifetime, because those certainly have changed. Think back when in your teens, did you have a hobby? Was there an activity you really liked to participate in? Might have been a sport, but it might have been a hobby. Did you used to like to color? Did you color between the lines, or did you go color out of the lines? Did you ever paint and give it up, or did you continue? Was there anything that you did when you were much younger that you picked up again 40 years later? When you look at your timeline, did you have a craft or a hobby you used to like to do as a teenager or in your 20s when you were raising children or working, and then you stopped it because you were raising your children or you went to work full time, but now in retirement, you pick it up again? The Senior Center has a lot of activities that might be drawing on, at least when we can get inside, but might be drawing on some of the things we used to like to do but gave up or stopped doing when we were raising our family or when we were developing our career. A lot of retirement is finding new things, but sometimes it's going back and looking at what we like to do as a teenager, saying, wow. When's the last time you went back to the first decade of your life and thought about it and thought, where did I live? And so for some of you, the first decade, you might have been 1 or 2 years old, and then you're moving into the next decade. So then you look at the first decade that you have memories. And we know from brain development research that we really, the part of the brain that does this memory, this long-term memory, really doesn't develop much until about the age of 3, but it even takes longer than that. So you might not have much memory at all until maybe you started kindergarten. And in retirement, in the older years, it's really a good time to reflect, but it's also a good time to not just reflect, but to really spend time doing and being what's most important for us at the age we are now. Because for all of us, we don't have as many years left as we did 20 years ago, 30 years ago. We don't have, and it's true that nobody ever knows how long they're going to live anyway. But we've lived as long as we are today. We've lived until 70, 80, however long we are now. And we know that our time is shorter. And so as an older person, it's an opportunity then to filter out what is important to me and what is not important, and to exercise what's important, exercise who is important, who is most important to me. I had a friend recently, and she said, because I said, you know, I should recontact with so-and-so. And she said, well, do you want to? And I says, no, not really, but I think I should. She says, you know, at our age, we need to dump the shoulds, unless we really, really have to, you know, for whatever reasons. But she says, no, I'm dumping a lot of that, and I'm reconnecting with people I want to reconnect with. So it's just a way that as we get older, it's an opportunity also to do and be with who is most important to us. Okay, so that's a little bit of this. Does anybody have any other thoughts? I know this is throwing a lot at you at a time. It can be simple or it can be more advanced, but as you look at this, keep looking at it too. Keep it open on your kitchen counter someplace and keep adding to it, unless you don't want to. What was your first car? Yeah. And what decade was it? And if you can remember how much it cost you, or how many repairs you had to do on that old car, or if you were lucky, maybe somebody bought you a Mercedes for your first car. Yeah. So those are the kind of things. So first car is another one. And then what cars have you had since then in the decades? Yeah. Okay. Well, I think we're doing pretty well. Anybody have anything else you might want to add? We'll thank Shelby for being here and providing all the goodies. Thanks, everybody. We'll see you in a month, and I'll see you before that somewhere else.